The Honourable Member for Saanich Gulf Islands.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I have never, not in all the time I went to law school and read legislation, and certainly not in the last 4 years that I've had the honour to serve the constituents of Saanich Gulf Islands in this place, I have never seen such an absurd excuse for a piece of legislation as this piece of nonsense. This law, so-called Zero Tolerance for Barbaric Cultural Practices Act, is nothing more than a bumper sticker in search of an offense. I'm deeply offended that this place has had to waste its time with debating this law. It's defended by those who stand up on the conservative side of the House and say, how can we not act to end honor killings? Well, if honor killings were rampant and Canada had no laws against honor killings, I would say we are well past time, by God, to eliminate honor killings. But murder's been against the law in Canada for a really long time. Ever since Confederation and well before it, murder's been against the law. It's extraordinary that something that goes under the absurdly exaggerated and emotionally laden, manipulative title of Zero Tolerance for Barbaric Cultural Practices Act could be brought to this place at all. We're also told we must end polygamy, forced marriage. These things are already illegal. Polygamy is illegal in Canada. Kidnapping someone to take them into a forced marriage. Well, we must end that. It's already illegal to kidnap someone and force them into a marriage. This act, issue on issue, is nothing more than emotionally manipulative nonsense. I started thinking of amendments, Mr. Speaker, and I started thinking, if we want to have a bill like this, Zero Tolerance for Barbaric Practices Act, Zero Tolerances for Barbaric Cultural Practices Act, I think it's about time that we eliminated and made it illegal to stone people in the village square. Long since time this Parliament acted against that. Or how about, why don't we have it in this law that it will be illegal to tie women to a stake and burn them at the stake? This bill speaks to things that are already illegal. So then what does it do that actually changes the current laws? This is where I'm also indebted to the speech we've just heard from my honourable friend in the New Democratic Party, who identified many of the failings in this piece of legislation. This piece of legislation had significant criticism for groups such as UNICEF, the Canadian Bar Association, concerned that in the ways that this law goes forward, in the absence of any public policy reason to bring forward S7 at all, it actually does damage to the scheme of laws in this country. So the concern that was expressed by many child advocates, and I also put forward amendments at committee to try to improve the sections of this law that actually do harm to the schemes of laws in Canada, to ensure that children not be caught up in this legislation. For instance, under this legislation, anyone who assists in the celebration of a marriage can be subject to penalty. And that could include children who are present, who assist in the form of a marriage, who are part of a family that is engaged in polygamy illegally. Certainly children shouldn't be subjected to criminal activities. My amendment to eliminate children from the celebratory observing of an illegal marriage were unsuccessful, as were similar attempts from the New Democrats. So we have a piece of legislation that is designed for election purposes. When I say bumper sticker, I mean it literally. It's not responding to a public policy problem. Honor killings are, of course, offensive, deeply offensive, are against the fabric of laws in this country. They're against our values. They speak to a manipulation and suppression of women that is unacceptable. All of that is already illegal. So let's look at what this law would do that could affect the lives of children. UNICEF said this in their brief, and I think it's always important to go back to the testimony of expert witnesses. UNICEF said, quote, UNICEF Canada is concerned about the risk of retribution to children implicated in a forced marriage situation that can result when a family member or an adult agent acting on their behalf is summoned to appear before a court possibly subject to a peace bond pursuant to proposed criminal law provision, criminal code provisions. We recommend, says UNICEF, that law enforcement authorities consult with child protection specialists to the extent possible before commencing a legal process involving criminal law sanctions so that less intrusive and or supportive alternatives to protect and assist the children and restore or preserve familial relationships can be identified. I'll skip down to another conclusion in the UNICEF brief because I think it's an important piece of evidence that an organization dedicated to the rights of children globally would have found problems with a Canadian law. This is, I don't think I've ever seen UNICEF present a brief to a Canadian legislative tribunal related to, and to a committee related to a piece of legislation like this. They recommend, quote, UNICEF, quote, we recommend that Canada take all due legal and administrative measures to ensure the unfettered access across borders by a child or children to a parent from whom they have been separated in the context of immigration, such as where a parent dissolves a polygamous union for the purpose of emigration to Canada and leaves a child or children behind in their country of origin, or where a parent is removed from Canada due to a polygamous union, but their Canadian-born children remain in Canada, close quote. The fact, again, Mr. Speaker, that concerns for children, that the, and I think quite inadvertent implications for depriving children of their rights, for further, as well, as my colleague from Pierre Fondeleur has already mentioned in detail, that we could actually be subjecting women to greater punishments through legislation that is at least ostensibly about acting in, to protect the rights of women. We've seen a number of briefs come forward, Mr. Speaker, that were concerned about this issue of the rights of women. And I turn to the brief from the Canadian Bar Association that also said that rather than protecting women, this would go against Canada's obligation to protect the human rights of all women, particularly those forced or coerced to comply with certain cultural practices against their will. Those women will not have the opportunity to come to Canada and be afforded the respect and protection that Canadian women are offered. Turning to another section of the bill, Mr. Speaker, so in addition to the fact that this bill is unnecessary, is making illegal things that are already illegal while trying to stir up the populace that somehow Canada is at risk from barbaric cultural practices, we see a quite unnecessary and regressive step in this legislation, and that is to change the criminal access to the criminal defense of provocation. Now, as a former lawyer myself, Mr. Speaker, the criminal, although I have to say I didn't practice in criminal law, but I certainly remember my criminal law jurisprudence, the defense of provocation is not one that could ever apply in an honor-killing situation. It is, by definition, a defense that is raised when something happens in the heat of the moment. So someone is overcome, lacks their ability to think through a situation because they are so provoked by the situation in front of them. Criminal law experts speaking to the committee, Mr. Speaker, and I'm going to cite the evidence of one in particular, Mr. Michael Pratt, who was at one point in the Canadian Bar Association head of their criminal law subsection. He is a criminal lawyer unlike, and was at one point vice president of the Defense Counsel Association of Ottawa. Mr. Pratt spoke to the unintentional consequences, or perhaps intentional if one were to be cynical, of depriving a defendant who needs the defense of provocation in a situation where manslaughter or murder has been committed. Now, what Mr. Spratt said was, quote, provocation requires that there be a wrongful act or insult that would be sufficient to deprive an ordinary person of the power of self-control. Honor killings, the purported justification for the amendments to provocation in this bill, don't meet that criteria. Our courts have time and time again rejected religion and honor as the basis of provocation, close quote. But what the criminal bar goes on to point out, and this wasn't the only submission, is that by depriving the defense of provocation where it is needed, one could do serious injustice in other cases. So in monkeying about with the defense of provocation, in the guise of eliminating that defense for someone who commits an honor killing, this will undermine the criminal law system in this country beyond the specifics of honor killing. Mr. Speaker, I close by saying that I hope that after October 19th, we won't see any other government decide to misuse the legislative process, to invent titles for bills that are intended to excite the population, titles of bills that are invented solely for electioneering. And we can go back in this place to doing the people's business by identifying public policy problems, bringing the best minds to bear, and bringing forth legislation that meets a real need, not a bumper sticker.
Questions and comments. The Honourable Parliamentary Secretary to the Minister of Citizenship and Immigration.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I listened to the member's rampage against this particular piece of legislation, and as I didn't heckle when she was speaking, and I would appreciate it if she didn't, Mr. Speaker, while I'm responding or asking a question to her dissertation. I will, however, say this, Mr. Speaker, that this is not a piece of legislation that the member suggests is created for partisan political advantage of some sort. She mentioned after October 19th and so forth. When we're debating a piece of legislation in the House, it's good if we focus on the legislation itself and keep that kind of rhetoric out of it. I know the member wants to satisfy some of her friends reacting in the way that she is. There are certain things in this piece of legislation that make it illegal for anyone who participates knowingly in an act that forces a marriage on a person that does not want to get married. Specifically, it amends the criminal code to introduce two new offenses of celebrating, aiding, or participating in the forced marriage ceremony and celebrating, aiding, or participating in the marriage ceremony of a person under the age of 16. These are clearly offenses that are not in the act right now. These are offenses that this particular bill will deal with. Does she not see that it is important to penalize those that assist in these atrocious acts being imposed?
The Honourable Member for Saanich Gulf Islands.
There's Mr. Speaker. I almost feel I need to rise on a point of personal privilege on this, but since I have the opportunity of responding to the Parliamentary Secretary's question, I would like to state for the record, and he cannot contradict this because it's fact, since the moment I took my seat in this place, I have not heckled any member at all, not once, never. So I found it gratuitous and insulting that he would begin his question by asking that I not heckle him. I never have heckled anyone, and I plan to continue in that practice. Secondly, Mr. Speaker, let me read the section that the Honourable Parliamentary Secretary glossed over. This is how it reads, subsection 293.2. Everyone who celebrates, aids, or participates in a marriage rite or ceremony, knowing that one of the persons being married is under the age of 16 years, is guilty of an indictable offence and liable to imprisonment for a term not exceeding 5 years. My attempts to make sure that this only applied to people 18 years of age and older was defeated at committee. On the face of it, Mr. Speaker, this language, celebrates, aids, or participates, is a very broad net and will include people who could well be under 18 and with no capacity to have been found guilty of an indictable offense, but here they will be.
Questions and comments. The Honourable Member for Algoma, Manitoulin, Kapuskasing.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I find very disturbing the comments from the Parliamentary Secretary on this particular issue. We have to look at the piece, and I think that it's been brought to light by the Speaker so far, that one of the words in there that's very problematic is the word cultural. And from what we've seen with the Conservatives' bills, which find themselves before the courts for the most part, and they lose for the most part, is that it's actually inciting racism and discrimination. And maybe my colleague can speak on that when you put something like that forward, whether it's the bill C-51, whether it's a national inquiry for missing and murdered Indigenous women that we have put forward. This government keeps pointing the finger at the culture as opposed to looking at the systemic problem. So my question to my colleague, and because we've seen in the UK that there's an opportunity there when you can actually invest in services. In Denmark, same thing. They're saying that they actually need more services. This is the way to go. So I'm just wondering if my colleague can talk about the how this legislation is actually inciting more racism and discrimination instead of having to deal with it, and as well as how important it is to invest in services that actually help victims.
Honourable Member for Saanich Gulf Islands.
I thank my honourable colleague for the question, and I agree entirely. This is part of a fabric, and she's certainly aware of it, Mr. Speaker. I think a lot of us here are, and it's disturbing because Canada's greatness and what makes this the best place in the world to live is our extraordinary success in multicultural harmony, really. We enjoy the fact that people have come here from all around the world. All of us here who aren't First Nations have come from somewhere else. And that level, it's not just tolerance, it's not just we can put up with each other. We actually are enriched by the diversity culturally. So whether it was the fake controversy over a woman wearing a niqab to a citizenship ceremony, stirring the pot, the Prime Minister in this place saying that the culture was anti-women, these kinds of comments which border on being, and they don't just border on them, they become anti-Muslim, this is exactly unhelpful at a time when we should be, as the member suggests, investing in services, increasing the levels of communication, avoiding radicalization, and ensuring those people from wherever they come from around the world that they are welcome and respected here.